Good evening, everyone. Let's stand and sing this evening.
The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star.
When we walk with the Lord,
says we will do. Where he sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey. For there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer that calls me from a world of care and bids me at my Father's throne. Makes
I'm enjoying this study, all right? And just kind of breaking down and looking minor prophet books that we call them, but there's really nothing minor about them. We only call them minor prophets because they're just not really as long as, you know, three chapters as compared to like 66 chapters of Isaiah and Jeremiah and, you know, Ezekiel, the bigger books there, as we might say, all right? But this was our fourth message in this study here out of the book of Joel, and I'll remind you a little bit of the context as we look at what we're going to look at tonight. But really, these verses that we're going to get to tonight in chapter 2 are really kind of the crux of the whole book, you know? I mean, Joel, up to this point, has really just been kind of sharing a message and prophesying and preaching for a verdict. And, you know, he didn't come onto the scene and he didn't preach some kind of a fluffy, feel-good, self-help kind of message. No, he didn't do that, all right? He was preaching to the people there of Judah, God's people, and he was preaching to them about their real condition, how they had disobeyed God, and they were just living in rebellion. And because of that, the wrath of God, the judgment of God, was going to, disaster was going to happen, and then there's going to be destruction. And so his goal wasn't to, you know, make them angry. He wasn't preaching to them to make them depressed, but his goal was to get them to act in order to do something, okay? I mean, you know, if you hear a sermon and the Lord speaks to you, well, it ought to move you, right? I mean, there ought to be some action on your part based upon the Lord speaking to you through his messenger and through his message. And so here's the crazy thing, though. He wasn't giving them the fluff. He wasn't giving them a motivational speech on how they can fix their own problems in their own strength. Because here's the thing. They couldn't do that. All right? I mean, they were not capable of fixing their own problems in their own strength. And so, remember, let me just kind of remind you of the context, all right? Remember what their immediate problem was. Remember the immediate problem? Back in chapter 1, there was the plague, where there was just the invasion of the locusts, right? And so the locusts come through, and so they are suffering the aftermath of this terrible locust invasion. Their livelihood is destroyed. The economy is in shambles, right? I mean, the locust just wiped everything out. And so the economy is in shambles. Their future is hopeless. And a matter of fact, they couldn't even go to worship and offer the grain offering or the drink offering or any kind of healthy animal to sacrifice. And so they're facing down starvation, not just physically, but also spiritually. And so, I mean, listen, it's a good thing. I'm not Joel, all right? Because if I was Joel, if I was there at that time, after the locust invasion comes through and wipes everything out, and then it's gone, then I would probably say, all right, fellas, here we go. Let's get the brooms out. Let's sweep up all the dead bugs. Let's clean up the mess. You know, let's get the water hose out and spray them down off the house. And let's get back to, you know, plowing the fields and putting the seed out, and we'll get the crops growing and doing all of that and just kind of, you know, trying to rebuild immediately. But that's not what Joel did, okay? Joel, he says, listen, the first thing that we've got to do is we've got to seek God's face, all right? I mean, that's really what we've got to do, and we're going to do it in a desperate way. You understand what I'm saying there, though? So many times when disaster hits in our own lives, I mean, it's like, well, we make a list, and I've got to get this, this, and this done, and really at the top of that list ought to be seeking God, okay? I mean, just pause and, you know, hit the pause button, right? And take time to seek out the Lord and do it in a unique way. And so that unique way that we're going to look at is what we're going to call a sacred assembly. A sacred assembly. Look in verse, go to verse 15 if you would. And look at what he says here in verse 15. Chapter 2, verse 15. Blow the trumpet in Zion. Consecrate a fast. Call a sacred assembly. And some translations read that as a solemn assembly, okay? But he says to call a sacred assembly. I believe that's exactly what you and I, as Bangham Heights, but just as the children of God, okay, as God's people, that we need to call a sacred assembly. I mean, listen, folks, over the past few weeks that we've already been studying here in Joel, have you had your eyes open to exactly how desperate our situation is? I mean, last week in chapter 2, the first 11 verses, remember it's all about the day of the Lord, right? And he says, the day of the Lord is near. And then Joel was talking about an invading army that was going to come at some point and carry them all captive. And so, but for you and I, the day of the Lord is the tribulation, okay? And we understand that, the day of the Lord is near. And so, I mean, all we've got to do is turn on the 5 o'clock news or the 6 o'clock news or the 9 o'clock news or the 10 o'clock news, right? I mean, we just turn on the news station, or we pick up a newspaper, or we get on social media, and it's all just, I mean, it's terrible. We understand that. And it just seems like every day, it just seems to get worse and worse and worse. And so I believe if we opened our eyes, then we would see that we are rapidly heading toward the time when God is going to, his patience is going to run out, and he is going to pour out his wrath upon his creation. And so throughout the Bible, and here in Joel, the theme is the day of the Lord. And Joel reminds us that the day of the Lord is near. Now, if you're like me, we want a timeline, don't we? You know? I mean, we kind of want God to say, well, okay, it's going to happen on such and such date of such and such year. Well, we don't know that, all right? But here's what we do know. I believe that the cup of God's wrath is on the brim. You know what I mean? That it's full, okay? And that his patience and his long-suffering has almost come to the end. Peter talks about it. I'm not going to read the verses, all right? But Peter talks about it over 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 9 and 10. I've made reference to that in the previous sermons, okay? But understand, listen, that day is coming. And this is what we talked about last week. In the first 11 verses, for the people of Judah in that time, the day of the Lord was the invasion of an army coming from the north to take them into captivity, or to annihilate them, to wipe them out. And so for you and I, the day of the Lord is coming. And it is soon. I don't know when that day will be, but listen, I believe the evidence is all around us. I believe the evidence is very clear, and I'm going to give you one prime example. You look at how Christians in other nations all over this world are being persecuted. Yeah, I mean, it's just intensifying. There are Christians that will be thrown in prison and just, you know, not cared for. There are Christians that will be beheaded. I mean, Christians that will just be shot or killed, whatever it is, but they are being brutally slaughtered all over this world. So make no mistake about it. I believe the day of the Lord is near. I don't know when, and we don't know when, but we do know that the cup of God's wrath is closer to overflowing than it's ever been before. So what does that do? That places you and I, and this has kind of been my word for the week, all right, precarious, okay? I mean, that just kind of puts us in a good situation, though, doesn't it? I mean, it really does. It is the fact that we are to be warning people about the judgment of God that is coming and the wrath of God that's coming. But remember, we don't just tell them the bad news, right? You know? We don't just tell them the bad news that God's going to judge this world, but we tell them the good news, and the good news is deliverance. And that deliverance can be found in Jesus Christ. And so, what do we do, though? I believe that this is a fitting message for the time that we're living in. What do? We call a sacred assembly. We gather the people of God together, and we say, all right, Joel, you've presented us with the Word of God. And so, what are we going to do about it? Are we just going to listen to the message and leave here this evening and just say, well, that was good Bible study, or that was some good preaching, amen, all right? But, you know, are we going to move? Are we going to act? Are we going to do something with what God tells us in His Word. And so I just want to give you a few things, all right? First of all, what is a sacred assembly? I don't really have a three-point outline this evening. We're just going to kind of look at what a sacred assembly is. That's kind of point number one, all right? What is a sacred assembly? Go back to verse 12 and look at what he says in chapter 2, verse 12. Now therefore, says the Lord, and this is the Lord himself, all right? I mean, up until this point, it was the prophet Joel, God speaking through the prophet Joel. But now, this is the Lord himself. He says, turn to me with what? All your heart. Now, if the Lord says, turn to me, then there is an implication there that there has been a turning away, right? I mean, if he says, turn to me, that means you've turned away at some point. And so he says, turn to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, and with mourning. Verse 13, so rend your heart and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God. Now here again, and we see this twice now, all right? Two times. In verse 12, he says, turn to me. And then in verse 13, he says, return to the Lord. So there again, there's an implication that if you are to return to the Lord, that means that you have what? You have gone away from the Lord, okay? And that's what we do, because what does the Bible say? All we like sheep have what? Gone astray, okay? And so as God's people, we go astray, we disobey, then disaster hits and destruction comes, and we finally come, we cry out for deliverance, okay? I mean, it's just kind of a cycle, almost like back in the Judges, you know? In the cycle that they had there in the times of the Judges. But here's what we do, though. We call a sacred assembly. You say, well, what is a sacred assembly? All right, I'm going to define it for you. I believe that it's a gathering. I mean, that's an assembly, right? Okay. It's a gathering of God's people, and we focus upon corporate prayer and fasting. Okay? Now, for those of you that know me, I mean, listen, fasting is nothing new, all right? I mean, I'm going to rehash the things I've already said about fasting, okay? But listen, though, I believe this is a time for God's people, and this is why I say, I am calling Bingham Heights, I'm calling out to God's people, because, and the reason I say that is because there might be one or two people that actually watch this on YouTube, all right? And so for those that actually watch this on YouTube, thank you so much. And if you're a child of God, then I want to encourage you to join us. And I'm calling out a sacred assembly, a time where we as God's people, we gather together, we pray, and we fast. Now, I know there's a lot of misunderstanding about fasting, okay? We're Baptists, and Baptists love to talk more about eating than not eating. Amen? I had to wake you up, all right? Okay? Because we do. I got a phone call this afternoon, and he says, what are you doing? And I said, I'm doing the thing that Baptist preachers love to do. He says, oh, you're eating fried chicken. I said, exactly. All right. I mean, that's just what I was doing. I was eating a chicken sandwich at the time, you know? I mean, because we love to talk about food. So let's understand what fasting is. Here's how I've always said what fasting is. It's denying the physical to gain the spiritual. Okay? Deny the self to gain the spiritual side, all right? But now I'm going to give you another definition of fasting. I thought this was pretty good, so listen to this. Somebody said fasting is voluntarily denying yourself a normal bodily function or activity for the sake of intense spiritual activity, okay? Now we're going to kind of break that down a little bit, all right? Listen to what he said. He said, first of all, it's completely voluntary. It is. Fasting is voluntary. We are Tennessee volunteers, right, okay? And so, but it is voluntarily. So even though I am calling us as a church to have a sacred assembly, I can't command you as an individual to do this, all right? But if you choose to do this, if you want to be a part of this, well, that's between you and God. But I hope and I pray that you will choose to join in. I'm not going to try to twist your arm. I'm not going to try to manipulate you. I'm not going to try to call you out or shun you if you don't. It is completely voluntary, just like prayer. It is, isn't it? I mean, have you ever noticed how many times in the Bible, when you see something about fasting, it always says something about prayer? It's like they go hand in hand. It's like peanut butter and jelly, right? I mean, so there's so many times that we will pray about something, but maybe we need to fast and pray as well. You understand what I'm saying? And so this is a call to a sacred assembly. It is completely necessary, but it is completely voluntary. All right? And so again, it's voluntarily denying yourself. Now, we don't like to deny ourselves, though, do we? We don't. I didn't deny myself that chicken sandwich. I didn't. I didn't deny myself that cake yesterday, all right? I mean, we don't like to deny ourselves, but I believe that's one of the reasons this is so crucial at this time. Now, you know, in the Bible talks about there's all kinds of different fasts, and I've talked about this before. And the most common fast is where you just abstain from all food for a certain period of time, and you only take in water or juices, you know. And that's a certain type of fast. Then there are partial fasts, and I know several of you have told me, you know, because we always do that 21-day fast starting right at the 1st of January, you know. And we spent 21 days in January starting out the new year and just really digging in and getting back into God's Word, because we just come off the holidays, right? You know, we're so full of the holiday stuff, right? And so, listen though, there's partial fast. And a partial fast says, well, I'm just going to give up a certain kind of food for a certain period of time. And there's all kinds of different fasts within the Word of God. Here's what I'm simply saying though. As we start this, as your stomach starts to growl, okay, because it's going to, and every time you get that urge to satisfy the flesh and to pick up some food, pick up the Word of God. That's what you do. You replace the physical with the spiritual. You let this right here be your bread. You let this, the Word, you let prayer. Whenever you get that desire to eat whatever that is that you're fasting from, then you just stop and you pray. And that prayer is going to sustain you. Now listen to me, all right? Because you know I say this with caution, okay? We're talking about fasting. I'm not talking about doing damage to your body. You understand what I'm saying there? I mean, I understand, if you're diabetic, if you've got sugar problems, if you've got heart problems, if you've got kidney problems, whatever, if you have any kind of medical dietary issues, listen, it is not a sign of faith to go against your doctor's orders and to fast from food. Listen, that ain't faith, that's foolishness. You understand the difference, right? So as you pray about this, then, you know, if there's something that you've got to have in order to live and to be healthy, then by all means, don't be foolish about it. Now, remember, you don't have to fast from just food. You remember that definition? It is voluntarily denying yourself a normal function or activity for the purpose of gaining spiritual. Okay? So you don't have to fast from a food. You can fast from television. Hey, turn off CNN. Amen? Turn off social media. Turn off the phone or whatever, but just listen. What I'm saying is, don't pick something to fast from that you don't practically, essentially already have in your daily existence. Okay? I've said this before. I'm not going to say, well, I'm fasting from broccoli. I don't eat broccoli in the first place. It doesn't work that way, all right? Okay? God's going to tell you. You pray and say, God, what is it that I need to give up for a little time here? And God's going to tell you what you need to give up and what you need to sacrifice. And He'll tell you that. And giving up TV or whatever it is, social media for the day, it's not going to cut it. It's going to be a little bit more than that. Listen, it's not to do harm to yourself. It's voluntarily denying something, though, for the sake of spiritual activity. It's a self-denial, so you hear the Savior speak to you. Does that make sense? Self-denial in order to hear what the Savior is calling you to do. Now, what is the purpose? What's the purpose of fasting? Don't miss this, all right? The purpose of fasting is not to manipulate God to get Him to do something we want Him to do, or to get Him to answer prayers the way we want Him answered. That is not the purpose of fasting. It is not to try and impress each other with how religious we are. That is not the purpose of fasting. The purpose is to go completely against the desires of our flesh and giving up something that we think sustains us. And we show ourselves to God and we say, God, I don't need this because I know that if I get this, You will sustain me. And He will. He'll do it. And so when that happens, and by the way, you're praying as you're fasting, right? Because they go together, okay? And so you're praying, and when this happens, then you're going to be driven to a place where you're going to cry out to God because He's the only one that can fix this. Joel didn't come on the scene. And verse 12, go to verse 12. Verse 12 doesn't say, the Lord didn't say, start planting the crops again. The Lord didn't say, sweep up all the dead locusts. That's not what He said. The locusts came, they devoured everything, they wiped out the economy. The people have nothing to offer, no grain offering, no drink offering, so they can't worship like they used to, right? Okay? And so what does God say? God says, return to Me. That's the message. Come back to Me. You've gone astray. Return to the Lord. Turn back to the Lord with all your heart. You can't do this on your own. So that's the what. What is a sacred assembly? We're gathered together in a time of prayer and fasting. The second point is this. Why? Brother Robert, why are you calling a sacred assembly? Well, let's go to verse 13. Rend your heart. And by the way, I love how he says this. Rend your heart and not your garments. Because you know in the Old Testament, you ever tried to just like rip your shirt? I can't do that, right? Because I don't have enough muscles, you know? But they would do that all the time in the Old Testament, wouldn't they? You know, they'd get mad about their sin, you know, and the consequences of that sin. And when they would go to repent, they would rip their tunic, you know. And God says, no, tear your heart open. That's what matters. And I love verse 13. He is gracious. Amen? He's merciful. Slow to anger. Thank God, He's slow to anger. He's of great kindness. This is why you ought to return to Him. This is why. Because He is a gracious God. He is a merciful God. He is slow to anger. He is of great kindness. And He relents from doing harm. Why should we call a sacred assembly? Right there you go. It's in verse 13, in verse 14. Who knows if he will turn and relent and leave a blessing behind him. See, here's the reality. The reality is, this is too big for us. There's a lot of things that we can do as a church in our own strength. Think about this. We can build big buildings. We can't. Shake head yes, all right? We can have big budgets. We can have big programs. We can attract lots of people to sit in our seats. We can have awesome music, and we can have these attractional ministries, and we can even go out into the community and we can do some community service to make ourselves feel good. And we can do lots of stuff, but in the end, it doesn't amount to a hill of beans. Because, listen, the fact is, our buildings and our budgets and our backsides in these seats, they don't mean a thing as long as people are dying lost. And when people die lost, we've not done our job. Doesn't matter how big the building is. It doesn't matter how big our budget is. It doesn't matter how many times we come and sit down and put our backside in the seat. Jesus said, go. What does that mean? It means we go. And we tell the good news. We tell them about our Savior. Turn on the news and what do you see? You see school shootings. Terrorism. Economic downturn. Problems. You see drugs everywhere, child abuse, human trafficking, abortion, and you start to think about all those problems. You understand what's at the very core of all of those problems, and then things that I didn't even mention. What's at the very core of all that? The heart. The human heart. You understand that's why he says in verse 13, rend your heart. And not your garment. The problem is, people have old, just cold, dead, stone-turned hearts of flesh. And the only thing that's going to transform that heart is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Only Jesus can do that. So are we going to take Jesus, though? That's the question. Why do we call a sacred assembly? I would say it like this, four words, people need the Lord. That's it. That's why we call a sacred assembly. That's why we get back to fasting. That's why we go back to praying. That's why, because people need the Lord. And we cannot do it in our own strength. It's got to take the Holy Spirit. We cannot do it on our own. God has to do it in us, and He has to do it through us, and He'll bring new life to those people. And so what do? We cry out. And we say, God, use me. We call a sacred assembly. We're going to voluntarily deny ourselves so we'll gain the spiritual. And so the next question is this. How? How do we go about it? All right? We're talking about what? We talked about why. Now let's talk about how. How do we go about a sacred assembly? Go to verse 15, all right? Go to verse 15. Blow the trumpet in Zion. Well, I'm not going to blow the trumpet. Okay? He toots your own horn, all right? He says what? Consecrate a fast. That word consecrate there in some translations is sanctify, right? Okay? What does that mean? It simply means that we're going to set apart, okay? We're setting aside a specific period of time that we, as God's people, are going to cry out, and we're going to fast, and we're going to pray, and we're going to seek His face. He says, call a sacred assembly. Gather the people. Sanctify the congregation. Assemble the elders. Look at it. You remember what I said, what I call one of the sub-themes of Joel is? The theme is the day of the Lord. To me, the sub-theme is this: return to the King and get back to worship. Get back in God's house. If that's not a message for America in 2021, I don't know what is. For the Christian, for the child of God, what does he say there? He says, gather the people, sanctify the congregation. Hey, listen, child of God, you set yourself apart from the rest of the world for a period of time. You deny self. You give up self and you give up this world and allow God to do something marvelous in your life. How are we going to do it? Well, this is what we're doing. Some of you are sitting there like, wait a minute, preacher. I didn't sign up for this. Yeah, you did. You just didn't know it, all right? This is not a me thing. Y'all understand that? I mean, all throughout the Bible, even in the New Testament, Jesus and his disciples fasted and prayed, did they not? And so I know it's a little radical for Baptists to talk about giving up food, but it's okay. It's all right. And if you're saying, well, this just ain't for me, listen carefully. Listen carefully. Don't tune me out yet, all right? If you're saying, wait a minute, this ain't for me, here's what's wrong with that. You need to open your eyes to the world around you. Open your ears. You get out. Just go to downtown Nashville on a Friday or Saturday night. But be back by Sunday morning, all right? You open your eyes. And you open your ears to the world around you. You'll see that we need a sacred assembly. Maybe we need to grasp the fact, or maybe we really don't grasp the fact that the only thing that's keeping God from pouring out His wrath upon creation right now is His patience and His long-suffering. Maybe it's because there's going to be a handful of people from this little community that's going to call a sacred assembly, and God's going to see this fasting, and He's going to hear our prayers. He's going to hear our cries. And we're going to say, God, we can't fix it. We can't fix it. Listen, it's not politics. Politicians ain't going to fix it either, all right? Don't amen that, but okay? Preachers ain't going to fix it. You say, we'll get a better preacher. You get a better preacher. He ain't going to fix it. The politicians ain't going to fix it. You say, well, we'll just start working with some better programs in the community. Better programs in the community ain't going to fix it. It's a heart problem. And the only thing that's going to change the heart is Jesus Christ. Amen. People need the Lord. Amen. They don't need programs or anything else. So we call a sacred assembly. We consecrate a fast. Now remember, if you can't fast from, you know, if there's certain foods that you need, then don't fast for those, all right? But you give up what God tells you to give up. Look at verse 16 again. Gather the people, sanctify the congregation, assemble the elders, gather the children and nursing babes, let the bridegroom go out from his chamber and the bride from her dressing room. Listen, from the elders to the infants. You can't sit there and say, I'm too old to do this. No. From the elders to the infants. From the young to the old. There's no age limit. All right? To participating in the fast. It's for everybody. So at least one more question. What are we going to cry out to God for? What are we going to cry out to God for? Verse 17, I'm done, all right? Look what he says. Let the priest who minister to the Lord weep between the porch and the altar. Let them say, spare your people, O Lord, and do not give your heritage to reproach, that the nations should rule over them. Why should they say among the peoples, where is their God? I don't know how many times, and I guarantee you, every single one of us would raise our hand, and at some point in our life, we have said, God, where are you at? Something happens in our life, or something happens in the life of somebody close to us, and we say, or something happens to us, and somebody else says, where's your God at now? I'm going to tell you exactly where he's at. He's still on the throne. He ain't left. And he's still on the throne. That's where he is. But people will say, where is your God? So what is it we're going to call a sacred assembly for and cry out to God for? Listen, I said this a moment ago, but it's worth repeating. The worst thing that can happen is if we just do this to say that we did it. I'm going to say that again. The worst thing that can happen is to say we did it just to say we did it. We don't just do it to say, well, we did it. That's not the purpose. Remember, the purpose is not to manipulate God to get him to do something we want him to do. The purpose is not religious. The purpose is not for people to look at us and say, well, look at those super spiritual people and they're fasting and they're praying. It's not about outward, it's about inside. It goes back to verse 13. It's not about tearing your shirt off, it's about opening your heart. Return to the Lord. Lord, soften our heart. Our hearts have become hardened stone. Our hearts are cold. Our hearts are indifferent to the people and the world around us. And so we're going to fast and we're going to pray and we're going to cry out to God with all of our hearts. And I've got a few specific things. So if you take notes, I want you to write these down, all right? Write these down. Here's what I'm going to encourage you to do. Starting tomorrow and going through next Wednesday until we come back, Lord willing, we come back next Wednesday night, okay? And we pick right back up in Joel where we're at with verse 18. So starting tomorrow and then until we come back next Wednesday night, I am calling a sacred assembly. It's voluntarily now, okay? It's completely necessary, but it's completely voluntary. But I'm going to encourage you to join me starting tomorrow, fasting, praying, crying out to God. And there are some specific things that I want you to pray about. Number one is this. I want you to fast and pray and cry out, first of all, for salvations and baptisms. That's got to be number one. That we say, hey God, I know people in my, matter of fact, I want to encourage you to make a list of names of unsaved people that you know. And you can go ahead and start praying for them right now. But then tomorrow, you start that fast and you start that prayer and you pray specifically by name for those lost people. And then let's pray for baptisms. Hey, my Bible says there's nothing too big for God. I'm paraphrasing, but that's what it says, all right? There ain't nothing that God can't do. So, is it too much to ask them to spend some time fasting and praying for about the next week, and we cry out to God, and we say, oh God, we ought to have this baptistry full every Sunday. We ought to be baptizing people and making disciples every single Sunday. Is that too much? I don't think it is. A Are we going to fast? Are we going to cry out and pray about it? The next thing I want you to do is this. Starting tomorrow, as you begin a fast and a prayer, and you join me in this, listen, I want you to cry out, and I want you to pray for deliverance from any besetting sin that you might have. In other words, that's repentance. Cleansing, okay? From all ungodliness, unholiness, unrighteousness, any sin. And I said besetting for a reason. We're going through a book in our Sunday school class right now that's just ripping me to shreds. But it's good. It's very good. And it's called Respectable Sins. It's those little subtle sins in our life that we just come to tolerate because we say, well, it's not that big of a deal, right? It's not like adultery. It's not like murder. It's not like any of those big sins. It's those little sins. Besetting sins. And so I want you to spend the next week and you fast and you pray and you say, God, cleanse me from all these besetting sins. Whatever it is, whether it's gossip, whether it's pride, whether it's lust, whether it's lying or worry, whatever that little sin is, listen, God will bring it to your heart. He'll bring it to your mind. You confess it. You repent of it. And you say, God, cleanse me from it. Cry out for Him to deliver you from that sin. Hey, that's not too big for God, is it? No. No. It's not too big. And then there's another thing. I want you to pray. And I want you to fast. And I want you to cry out to God, for this church to experience a supernatural unity and healing. We're hurting. And you know that. And I don't have to tell you that. I think we need to call a sacred assembly. And we need to start tomorrow just crying out to God and say, God, yes, we need to be unified. And God, we need healing in our body. And then the last thing is this. I want you to fast and I want you to pray and I want you to cry out to God that He will leave a blessing behind. I love what it says in verse 14. Verse 14. Who knows? I don't know. Who knows? If He will turn and relent and leave a blessing behind Him. Let's fast about it. Let's pray about it. Let's cry out to God and pray that God will leave a blessing behind. I don't know what that blessing may be. It may be the blessing of a revival to break out. I pray that it's going to be multiple salvation decisions and multiple baptisms and disciples being made, lives being changed and transformed right here in this place. All I'm asking is for the next week, starting tomorrow until next Wednesday night when we come back, that you cry out to Him in fasting and praying like you've never done before. Can I just confess something to you? Have I had confession time in a while? This is a good time. Sometimes the place that I do my best crying out to God, because I want to be vocal. I mean, you understand when it says cry out, it means He really got loud. He cried out, okay? Is when I'm alone, driving down the road. Because there's nobody else with me. Nobody else going to hear me, right? I'm just driving down the road. I turn the radio off. I get along with God. God, and I let it loose. I'm crying out to God. Find a place. Get a prayer closet. Go somewhere. If you need to come in here, you come in here. And you get alone with God, and you cry out as loud as you want to cry out. Pour out your heart to God. Return to Him. Who knows what blessing He'll leave behind. Would you bow with me? Heavenly Father, Lord, You are gracious. God, You are merciful. Lord, we thank You that You're slow to anger and You are of great kindness. Lord, we understand from Your Word, even a message given through the prophet Joel, but a word that we need today in our own lives. God, that we have drifted away from We've turned our backs on You. And Lord, we realize we cannot do this in our own strength. It's not about our buildings and it's not about our budgets. Lord, You have called us and You're telling us. You are inviting us to return to You. Lord, this fast and this prayer, we understand it's not an outward thing. It's in rip our hearts open. Lord, expose any little sin. Because, Lord, we know that there is no such thing as a little sin. That sin in Your eyes is an affront to a holy God. And Lord, that You'll cleanse us and You'll make us whole again. Lord, You'll sanctify us and You'll set us apart for Your service. Father, we need Your Spirit to work in us, to work through us, Lord, to show Your love and Your joy and Your peace, Your patience, Your kindness, Your faithfulness, so many. Father, I pray that these here this evening, and Lord, I know there's some that couldn't be here, and maybe they'll watch this on YouTube, but Lord, I pray they'll join in with me on this sacred assembly. And Lord, that they will fast, and they'll pray, and they'll cry out to You. Hey, God, You're going to speak to them. You're going to reveal Yourself to them as an individual in some way. And Lord, I can't wait to hear the testimony. Can't wait for people to come and tell me about how good and just how You're speaking to them and what You're doing in their life. So Lord, we know You've got good things in store. We don't know what that blessing is, but Lord, we pray that one of the fruits of this sacred assembly, Lord, was that You'll leave a blessing behind. We can look back on this and we can say, wow, only God can do that. It wasn't us. It was all You. We'll give You all the glory.